Good afternoon, everyone. And the first item of business this afternoon is consideration of business motion number 14424 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, setting out a timetable for the Stage 3 consideration of the Human Trafficking and Exploitation Scotland Bill. I would ask any member who wishes to speak against the motion to please press the request speak buttons now. And I now call on Minister Joe Fitzpatrick to move motion number 14424. Minister.
Moved.
Many thanks. As it appears no member has asked to speak against the motion, therefore I'll now put the question to the chamber, and the question is that motion number 14424 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. Thank you very much. And now the next item of business, therefore, is Stage 3 proceedings on the Human Trafficking and Exploitation Scotland Bill. And in dealing with the amendments, members should have with them the bill as amended at Stage 2, the marshalled list and the groupings. The division bell will sound and proceedings will be suspended for 5 minutes for the first division of the afternoon. The period of voting for the first division will be 30 seconds, and thereafter I will allow a voting period of 1 minute for the first division after a debate. Members who wish to speak in the debate on any group of amendments should press the request to speak buttons as soon as possible after I call the group. Members should now refer to the marshalled list, and we will now turn to the marshalled list. And so we will start at Group 1, which is exploitation for the purposes of the offence of human trafficking. And I call Amendment 1 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary in a group on its own. Cabinet Secretary to move and speak to Amendment 1, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Section 3 of the Bill describes cases of exploitation for the purposes of the human trafficking offence in Section 1. Subsection 8 deals with cases where a victim is used to provide services or benefits for another person on the basis of their vulnerability. The Bill, as currently drafted, requires that a person using a victim in that way must have chosen the victim on the basis that they are a child or a vulnerable adult. We have reflected upon the concerns raised by Jenny Marra at Stage 2 and also on similar concerns which were raised in written evidence by the Legal Services Agency. Although we remain of the view that the package of amendments to Section 3(8) proposed by Jenny Marra at Stage 2 went too far, we are satisfied that there is a case for modification of Section 3(8). Not least, the current provision may require the thought process of the accused or any other person involved in exploitation to be established in evidence in court, which may be problematic and may make securing convictions difficult. Amendment 1, therefore, removes the reference to the choice made by the person exploiting the victim. Instead, it focuses Section 3(8) on the victim's vulnerability. It would therefore be sufficient to establish exploitation under Section 3(8) for a child or vulnerable adult to have been used to provide services or benefits to another person if a person who is not a child or vulnerable adult would have been likely to refuse to provide those services or benefits. Again, I'd like to thank members of the committee and Jenny Marra and other stakeholders for highlighting the fact that an amendment in these terms would improve the practical implementation of the bill, and I move Amendment 1.
Many thanks, and as no member is asked to speak, the question is that Amendment 1 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. Many thanks. We now move to Group 2 and call Amendment 2 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, group with Amendment 12. I invite Cabinet Secretary to move Amendment 2 and speak to other amendments in the group, please.
Officer, as I have indicated throughout the passage of this bill, this government wants to create a society in which all children and young people have the right to be cared for and protected from harm and can grow up in a safe environment. And I will speak to my Amendment 2, which supports this ambition. Members are aware that Section 4 of the bill deals with the offence of slavery, servitude and forced or compulsory labour. Section 4(3) provides that a court must, in determining whether a person is being held in slavery or servitude or required to perform forced or compulsory labour, have regard to any personal circumstances of a person which may make that person more vulnerable than others. Amendment 2 is intended to provide absolute certainty that being a child, as defined in Section 36 of the Bill, is a personal circumstance that makes a person more vulnerable than others to being exploited in this way. If the amendment is accepted, the Bill would be clear that a court would need to have regard to the fact that a victim is a child, given the particular vulnerability of children to exploitation, and I hope that all members can support Amendment 2. Amendment 12, in the name of Jenny Mara, seeks to further adjust Section 3.4 of the Bill. It would require courts to consider any work or services provided by potential victims of the slavery, servitude and forced or compulsory labour offences. That would expressly include work or services provided in circumstances constituting exploitation for the purposes of the separate offence of human trafficking. In determining whether an offence has been committed under Section 4, courts and juries are already permitted to consider any form of work or service provided by a victim, provided that its work or service provides it provided in circumstances which amount to a breach of Article 4 of ECHR. Not all forms of exploitation listed in Section 3.3 or to 3.8 will necessarily amount to a breach of Article 4. So this amendment will make the scope of Section 4 offences less clear. Amendment 12 also links the Section 1 and Section 4 offences. We take the view that the distinction between the offences should be maintained, because conflating these issues may make the scope of the individual offence less clear, and any confusion in that respect could jeopardise the prospect of successful convictions. We have demonstrated that we have been prepared to review the wording of Section 1 and 4 by bringing forward amendments to both at Stage 2 and Stage 3, having listened carefully to members and other stakeholders. However, in the case of Amendment 12, we are satisfied that no further change is needed and that the scope of Section 4 is sufficiently clear to allow for successful prosecutions in appropriate cases. I therefore ask members to support Amendment 2 in my name, and I ask Jenny Mara not to move Amendment 12, and I move Amendment 2.
Many thanks. I now call on Jenny Mara to speak to Amendment 12 and other amendments in the group, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome the Government's Amendment 2, which provides much needed clarity that the situation of children and their particular vulnerability to slavery and forced labour should be taken into account when deciding if an offence under Section 4 has occurred. However, there is another aspect of the offence that needs to be addressed to ensure that Section 4 does enable the law to prosecute effectively those who exploit children. Because Section 4 has a much narrower definition than the human trafficking offence, because it contains within it no clear definitions of slavery, servitude or forced or compulsory labour, nor does it benefit from wider definition of exploitation in Section 3, which pertains only to the Section 1 human trafficking offence. I am concerned, Presiding Officer, despite the Cabinet Secretary's remarks, that this may present an obstacle to prosecuting cases of child exploitation. Children are often exploited in ways that are less defined than forced labour and servitude, including forced criminal activities such as cannabis cultivation or shoplifting, and to enable others to obtain benefits such as fraudulent benefits claims. Such forms of exploitation can be prosecuted under the Section 1 offence of human trafficking through the related definition of exploitation in Section 3. However, if the details of the case do not allow a human trafficking charge to be brought, Section 4 does not cover these forms of exploitation so clearly. Amendment 12, which I now formally move, specifically allows the court to consider these wider circumstances of exploitation in determining if a Section 4 offence has been committed. This will enable prosecutions under Section 4 where the form of exploitation may not easily be defined narrowly as forced labour or human trafficking.
Many thanks. Margaret Mitchell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm sympathetic to Jenny Marrow's amendment, which widens the definition of exploitation from servitude or forced and compulsory labour to include forced criminal activities such as trafficking in connection with the cultivation of cannabis, something that I don't think people are widely aware of, despite the fact there are cannabis farms being discovered practically in a daily basis in Scotland. So to me, it makes sense and would be an improvement if her amendment was passed today.
Many thanks. I now call on the Cabinet Secretary to wind up.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I think it may be helpful if I clarify this matter a bit further, because as the bill stands at the present moment, any form of work will come within the scope of Section 4, provided that the work is done in circumstances that means that it amounts to slavery, servitude or forced or compulsory labour, as set out in the terms within Article 4 of ECHR. So if a person, including a child, if forced to do something in relation to, for example, the example used by Jenny Marra, forced to, in relation to take undertake work in relation to cannabis cultivation, or to carry out something such as shoplifting for another person's benefit, that would come under the offence within Section 4 of the bill. So the specific example that Jenny Marra made reference to is actually covered by Section 4 of the bill, which is why we don't believe it's necessary to amend this particular section of the bill.
Many thanks. And so the question is that Amendment 2 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
Did someone say no? We are all agreed then.
No, we're not.
Right, so the question... Can I ask the question again, because I'm afraid I didn't hear the answer clearly. So the question is that Amendment 2 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. Now call Amendment 12 in the name of Jenny Marra, already debated with Amendment 2. Jenny Marra, to move or not?
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 12 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not agreed. So there will be a division, and as this is the first division of the stage, I suspend for 5 minutes. And so we will now proceed with the division on Amendment 12. This is a 30-second division, and members should cast their votes now, please. Result of the vote on Amendment number 12 is yes 49, no 61. There were no abstentions, and the amendment is therefore not agreed. Now move to Group 3 and call Amendment 3 in the name of Rhoda Grant, Group of Amendment 21. Rhoda Grant, to move Amendment 3 and speak to other amendments in the group, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I move Amendment 3 and speak to Amendments 3 and 21? Sexual exploitation is a major driver for human trafficking. A person can be sold over and over and over again, making them very profitable to traffickers. In recognition of this connection, at stage two, I brought forward amendments that would criminalise the purchase of sex, seeking to make those that feed this industry directly responsible for their actions. As part of these amendments, I also sought to decriminalise those in prostitution, regardless of whether they were trafficked or not, because in Scotland we recognise that prostitution is violence. It's clearly outlined and equally safe and signed up to by the majority of members of this Parliament. I also tabled an amendment at that time requiring the Scottish Government to provide exiting services for those in prostitution, again for those who are and are not trafficked. Help for victims should be the utmost priority. In response to calls from those who responded to the Government and Committee consultation on this bill highlighting the need for this approach, the Cabinet Secretary commissioned a review of research in this area in order to make an informed decision. Because of this, I decided against tabling those amendments again in order to allow the Cabinet Secretary space and time to commission and receive this research. I also understand that this research will involve stakeholders. My amendments today are placed in recognition of this work, setting it in a legislative framework to ensure that it's in keeping with the Violence Against Women strategy, Equally Safe, encompassing a gendered analysis of violence against women. The final part of my first amendment today requires the Cabinet Secretary to put on record his response to that research and consultation. Amendment 21 is a consequential amendment. Presiding Officer, these amendments are measured and in keeping with the Scottish Government's own policy. Indeed, they take into account the progress being made by the Scottish Government, albeit turgidly slow, and to take them at their word when they tell us they understand that sexual exploitation, whether or not the victim is trafficked, is violence against women. In light of this, I sincerely hope the Scottish Government and Parliament will accept these amendments, which are in keeping with current Scottish Government policy.
Many thanks. Now Colin Jean Urquhart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I would like very much to speak against this amendment for different reasons. I think we've heard from Rhoda Grant just now that this is about violence against women. Well, I think that violence against women is abhorrent. I think it's worthy of a much bigger debate, but not one through passing the bill on human trafficking. While I don't doubt that there may well be violence against women in the act of trafficking human beings, that is not to be singled out on this case. There is the acts of violence against men and women and children that we hope that this bill will address. There is no evidence to highlight the prostitution as one particular area that is worse through human trafficking than any other. Human trafficking can be slavery of the worst sort in different professions, be they agricultural or other areas of work where people are driven as slaves. And not only prostitution. Whatever the debate around prostitution, it should not be carried out through this debate, which is about human trafficking. Thank you.
Thanks very much. Call Graham Pearson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I stand to speak in support of Rhoda Grant's amendment. I think it's unfortunate that Jean Urquhart takes the view that she does, but in so doing, she'll be aware that many others, both in this chamber and out in the public domain, would disagree with the views that she's expressed this afternoon. It seems to me there's been a huge controversy around this whole area of the abuse of women and the sale of sexual services. So the impact of Rhoda Grant's amendments is, first of all, to acknowledge the government's work in this field, but to encourage a report back to the very Parliament so that all parliamentarians benefit from that review and that we have the ability to deal with evidence and not supposition. So I would support Rhoda Grant's amendments in this case.
Thank you very much. I now call on Dr. Elaine Murray.
Yes, I too would like to speak in support of Rhoda Grant's amendment and to point out to the Chamber that the issue relating to this bill is actually the control of demand for women for sexual exploitation, which is related to the crime of human trafficking. However, Rhoda Grant's amendments today do not actually specifically refer to the criminalisation of the purchase of sex. It purely asks for a report on the research which the government is undertaking at this very time, and at this Parliament should have view of that research and have the opportunity to assess whether that sort of exploitation of women, which we, many of us in this chamber, believe is a form of violence against women, whether that has to be regulated.
Thanks. Call Alison MacInnes.
Thank you very much. This chamber has never shied away from discussing these things, but it seems to me a most unusual way to try and get a debate to move forward by putting this amendment onto the face of this particular bill. I don't doubt Rhoda Grant's sincerity in this matter, but Rhoda has already had this issue debated at stage two, when we made it very clear from the committee's point of view that it was not appropriate to bring that discussion into the bill at that late stage. It has already been, an assurance from the Minister has already been given at stage two on the record that this research would be carried out, and it does seem to me unusual to press this amendment.
Many thanks. I call Malcolm Chisholm now.
Presiding Officer, I'm not quite sure how anyone could deny that there is a strong link between the sex trade and human trafficking. Clearly, there are lots of other aspects of human trafficking, but who can deny that there is a strong link? And it is necessary to look at the whole issue of tackling demand. And many of the written evidence on the bill highlighted that, the STUC being one example, Tara, that Jenny Mara, I believe, visited this morning, and all credit to them for the great work they've done, also saying that the issue of tackling demand has to be addressed. Now, I myself would see this whole issue through a gender inequality prism, but in a sense, you don't necessarily need to take that particular view in order to believe that research would be helpful in informing the debate about the wider issues. Clearly, Jean Urquhart is introducing this shortly through her bill more generally and a different perspective, but surely research will inform that wider debate as well as being relevant to this particular bill. So I don't think actually voting for this amendment necessarily commits you to holding the view that certainly Rhoda Grant has put forward. I think research is important in itself, and it's certainly an issue that's relevant to the trafficking bill, so I support Rhoda Grant's amendment.
Many thanks. Call on Elaine Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This is an issue that's been debated over a number of years, and prostitution is very firmly recognised by the Scottish Government as being on the spectrum of violence against women and children. And most of those involved in prostitution are vulnerable, with a great many being trafficked, so I think it is entirely appropriate that this amendment has been brought forward with regard to this legislation. It therefore seems only logical to me that purchasers should be criminalised whilst the victims should not be. And in my opinion, that would help to stop trafficking. And surely research would be very little to ask. And if it's already been agreed to, then I don't see any reason why we should not be supporting this amendment today. So I rise to support the amendment.
Thanks so much. Call Margaret Mitchell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Had the amendment stopped really just with commissioning research, we would have supported it. However, it does go on to be more prescriptive. In general, I don't believe that this is the right place for this discussion to take place. And in fact, I think it does it a disservice to try and promote this particular amendment in this bill, going on as it does to talk about the response then triggering legislation. Furthermore, I do believe that there's an opportunity to move this forward, perhaps even in a more timely fashion, by including it and a discussion of the whole issue in the Behaviour and Sexual Harm Bill. So for these reasons, regretfully, we won't be supporting the amendment.
Thank you very much. Call Jani Mara.
Presiding Officer, I would reiterate my colleague's comments that this amendment has actually been very carefully worded by my colleague Rhoda Grant, so that the Cabinet Secretary consider the evidence on this. And indeed, this amendment has been informed by how the Government wanted to take this forward. I'm very surprised by my colleague Jean Urquhart's remarks on this to deny the link between prostitution and trafficking. We have taken the Government's approach. We have taken the Government's approach to separate these, but I would think it would be fair to recognise that we haven't actually been able to have a full debate or vote on this issue in this chamber before, because the SNP have not supported any moves on to criminalise the purchase of sex. I would strongly encourage the government benches to support Rhoda Grant's amendment to review the evidence on this and take this measure forward. And I expect a progressive government, or stands up to be progressive, to do that this afternoon. I think it would be embarrassing if they didn't.
Thanks so much. Call Jim Hume. Jim Hume.
Apologies.
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. At stage two of this bill, the Scottish Government made it clear our views that this bill is not the appropriate legislation to deal with the substantive and complex issue of criminalising the purchase of sexual services. And I believe that that is still the case. However, I acknowledge that there are wide-ranging views on this matter, and I welcome the opportunity to set out the Scottish Government's position regarding Amendments 3 and 21 that have been lodged by Rhoda Grant. I would like to begin by making clear that the Scottish Government very much respects the strongly held views on both those in support of criminalisation and those who oppose criminalisation. Rhoda Grant and those who support criminalising the purchase of sexual services point to the research that has been undertaken to show the Swedish or the Nordic model is working to reduce the demand for sex and is preventing sexual exploitation and trafficking. However, those who oppose criminalising the purchase of sexual services point to other research that shows that the Nordic model is not working, and sexual workers have become more vulnerable as a result of the criminalisation of the purchase of sex. Therefore, it's clear that there is a lack of consensus to the conclusions that may be drawn from existing international research and the relevance of that research to the specific circumstances of prostitution here in Scotland. That is why I committed during stage two of the bill that the Scottish Government would commission research into this matter. And I also confirmed that the findings of that research would be published in February 2016. When I met Rhoda Grant on the 15th of September, I explained that the Scottish Government had already commissioned the Scottish Centre for Crime and Justice Research to undertake a desk-based review on the impact of criminalising the purchase of sexual services and the review of the existing literature on prostitution in Scotland. To supplement this evidence, researchers within the Scottish Government Justice Analytical Services will be working with relevant agencies and key stakeholders to explore and summarise up-to-date evidence on the nature and scale of prostitution in Scotland. This will include a summary of existing evidence on the scale and nature of sex work, the evidence on the number and profile of victims who have been trafficked for sexual exploitation and links to organised crime, the impact of prostitution on local communities, the scale and nature of the demand of prostitution and services, and the scale and nature of existing support services and assessment of these services. This research will involve police, local authorities and key health boards, and researchers also intend to speak to a range of third sector organisations, including TARA, Women's Aid, Glasgow Community Safety Services and Women's Support Project. Both strands of the research will be subject to independent scrutiny by academics to provide a quality assurance check. The implications of the research findings will then be discussed with key stakeholders, an event which has now been planned for February next year. This will focus on the possible impact of criminalisation of the purchase of sex, taking account of the circumstances in Scotland and to determine whether further work is required. Rhoda Grant's Amendment 3 and 21 under the bill would not assist the conduct or the delivery of the research that is already in progress. Indeed, if the Scottish Government was statutorily obliged to undertake the research project in the way set out by Rhoda Grant's amendment, I'm advised that it would not be possible for the report to be finalised in February 2016, as I've already set out to Parliament. Signed officer, the Scottish Government has not come to a policy decision on the merits or otherwise of criminalisation of the purchase of sexual services. We will not reach such a decision on this until such times as the research and findings of the workshop are published and considered properly. The Scottish Government considers this bill is not the appropriate vehicle for legislating on the criminalising the purchase of sexual services, including the timescale for research or for making policy decisions, nor do I think that the provisions on the detailed method and content of research are appropriate as a legal requirement within this bill. For those reasons, I would invite Rhoda Grant not to press Amendment 3 and 12.
Thank you very much. I call Rhoda Grant to wind up and press a withdrawal amendment.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I think a number of people who spoke against this amendment were actually speaking against my Stage 2 amendments, which I explained I was not placing, but actually taking account of the work that the Government was already doing. The amendment today actually enshrines in legislation the research that was highlighted by the Cabinet Secretary just there. It follows the same timescales as the Cabinet Secretary. Indeed, the report back gives him more time than he has outlined today. I welcome that he's saying he's going to pull stakeholders together in February. There is nothing in this amendment that stops that happening. It only puts in legislation what the Government's position already is, but asks them to report back to the Parliament within a year of that research being published. This is a measured approach, and I would urge the Scottish Government to rethink their stance on this and vote with myself and on my amendment tonight.
Many thanks. And so the question is that Amendment 3 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not. There will therefore be a division, and this will be a 1 minute division. Result of the vote on Amendment number 3 is yes 27, no 79. There were no abstentions, and the amendment is therefore not agreed. Now move to Group 4 and call Amendment 4 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, grouped with Amendment 5. I invite the Cabinet Secretary to move Amendment 4 and speak to other amendments in the group, please.
Amendment 4 and 5 responds to specific concerns raised by Elaine Murray and others at Stage 2 and subsequently with regards to Section 7 of the Bill. Section 7 requires the Lord Advocate to issue instructions to prosecutors on the prosecution of victims. I note that a fresh draft of instructions reflecting stakeholders' views have now been issued by the Lord Advocate and shared with the Justice Committee, and a copy have also been placed in SPICE. The concerns related firstly to the fact that while the draft instructions to be issued under the bill deal separately with adults and children, there is no specific mention in the bill of the application of the instructions to children. There was also a concern in relation to compulsion, in particular that compulsion should not require to be established when determining whether to prosecute child traffic victims. Having considered these issues, we have brought forward Amendments 4 and 5. Amendments would therefore adjust Section 7 of the Bill to make clear that the Lord Advocate's instructions now and in the future must always contain provision about the factors to be taken into account or steps to be taken by prosecutors when deciding whether to prosecute children who are victims of the offence of human trafficking or slavery, servitude and forced or compulsory labour, and who appear to have committed an offence as a consequence of their being such a victim. These amendments would accordingly remove the focus on compulsion to commit an offence as far as children are concerned. And as such, I would ask Parliament to support Amendment 4 and 5 in my name, and I move Amendment 4.
Thanks. Now call Alison McInnes.
Thank you. I want to speak in support of Amendment 4 and 5 and thank the Cabinet Secretary for bringing this forward. This will make the evidential test within the Lord Advocate's instructions regarding prosecution of child victims different and simpler. Removing the compulsion element reflects the particular indirect pressures that children who have been trafficked might face, and I welcome them.
Thank you. Now call Dr. Elaine Murray.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I too would like to welcome these amendments. As the Cabinet Secretary said, they address concerns that were raised with us at Stage 2 and were discussed at Stage 3, which now recognise the additional vulnerabilities of children who have been trafficked, and therefore we welcome those greatly.
Many thanks, Cabinet Secretary, to wind up. And since the Cabinet Secretary does not wish to wind up, the question is that Amendment 4 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Yes. We are. Thank you very much. Call Amendment 5 in the name of Cabinet Secretary. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Moved.
Many thanks. And so the question is that Amendment 5 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are. Many thanks. And we now move to Group 5. Call Amendment 6 in the name of Margaret Mitchell, Group of Amendments 11 and 22. Margaret Mitchell to move Amendment 6 and speak to all amendments in the group, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Amendment 6, 11 and 22 would provide a statutory defence for victims on the face of the bill. There is a precedent for such a defence in the UK Modern Slavery Act 2015 and Northern Ireland's human trafficking legislation. The possible inclusion of this provision was widely discussed with stakeholders at Stage 1, and Elaine Murray tabled amendments at Stage 2 which aimed to introduce a statutory defence. At that time, the Cabinet Secretary identified a loophole in the Stage 2 amendment. This was because it left the listing of offences to be done through regulations. However, this list would need to be composed prior to the commencement of the section, as there was no requirement in the Stage 2 amendments for that to be done. It was withdrawn. Amendment 22 remedies that omission. The Scottish Government and the Lord Advocate in particular have continued to oppose the inclusion of a statutory defence for the following reasons. One, it would govern and influence any instructions that were produced. Two, it would place a burden on the victim to raise a defence. And three, it would apply only to a small number of people. Taking each of these in turn, it has been established and accepted by the Scottish Government at Stage 2 that the Lord Advocate's instructions and a statutory defence are not mutually exclusive. In other words, you can have both, and a statutory defence would ensure there was additional protection available for victims, which brings me to the second point. Rather than this placing a burden on victims, it provides them with a safety net. In fact, the fact that it would only apply to a small number of individuals is not a reason to deny people the right to this added protection. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, I want to make the Chamber aware of one final point and an extremely important one highlighted by the Law Society of Scotland. It argues that if there is no statutory defence available, then the accused may find himself or herself in the situation where the prosecution don't accept the accused position regarding compulsion, i.e. they were forced into criminal activity, on the basis that it is the Lord Advocate's decision whether or not to prosecute, then he, in effect, becomes judge and jury. And this means that the protection and the additional protection afforded to victims in terms of a statutory defence, which is available elsewhere in the United Kingdom, would be denied the same victims in Scotland. I move Amendment 6 in my name.
Thank you very much. Now call Alison McInnes.
Thank you. I rise to speak against Amendments 6, 11 and 22. When the bill was first introduced, I supported the idea of a statutory defence, and I have wrestled with the issue as the bill has gone through committee. I had thought that the instructions and the statutory defence would not be contradictory, and that a statutory defence would perhaps be a safety net for anyone who was not picked up by the earlier procedure. And we heard indeed from Aberlour Child Care Trust in particular that some young victims of trafficking had been prosecuted. However, the Lord Advocate has made a compelling case for the alternative approach of instructions, and the Cabinet Secretary has also at times restated that case. In this instance, instructions, I believe, will lead to a more victim-centred approach and allows us for the earliest intervention and the most support to be available. The Lord Advocate has argued quite clearly, and I quote, if a statutory defence was introduced in legislation, this would result in a two-tier system for potential victims of trafficking, as my instructions would only apply post-conclusion of criminal proceedings. Chamber, we need to keep victims of trafficking outside the criminal cases as much as possible. And in this instance, I would urge members to vote against the amendment.
Many thanks. Now I call Dr. Elaine Murray.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. This indeed is very similar to amendments which I brought at stage two, but as Margaret Mitchell has indicated, she did address the technical objection which the Scottish Government raised at that time. At the time we were considering the stage two amendments, the Lord Advocate had issued a letter that very morning which no one had had the opportunity to discuss with the stakeholders who were supportive of a statutory defence, and I subsequently asked both the Law Society and the Faculty of Adverts to have a look at the letter issued by the Lord Advocate. And indeed, the Law Society, as Margaret Mitchell has indicated, continues to have concerns, and I quote from their briefing, we continue to question whether the duty of the Lord Advocate in terms of Section 7 of the Bill as amended to issue and public instructions about a victim of trafficking taken on its own, meets with Article 26 of the European Convention on Action Against Trafficking, which states that each party shall, in accordance with the basic principles of its legal system, provide for the possibility of not imposing penalties on victims for their involvement in unlawful activities to the extent that they have been compelled to do so. And the Law Society also point out that our bill, as stands, would not give victims the same amount of defence as they would have under the Modern Slavery Act 2015 in England and Wales or the Human Trafficking and Exploitation Act in Northern Ireland of 2015.
Thank you very much. Now I call the Cabinet Secretary. Beg your pardon, a late call from Mr Finney. Forgive me, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, President Officer. I stand to support the position adopted by my colleague Alison McInnes. I think Elaine Murray is quite right to say there's been a lot of exchange about legal matters, and we had a very interesting legal debate within the Justice Committee. People might instinctively say, be minded to support something headed up defence for victims of offences, but what we want to do is prevent people ending up in the dock in the first place, and the approach adopted by the Lord Advocate is a way of doing that, so I certainly do not support Margaret Mitchell's amendments.
Many thanks. Now call the Cabinet Secretary.
Signing Officer, I welcome the opportunity to address Amendments 6, 11 and 22 in the name of Margaret Mitchell, and once again to set out the Scottish Government's position on a statutory defence for victims of human trafficking, slavery, servitude and forced or compulsory labour. I do not believe that the case has been made that adding a statutory defence would provide any further benefits to victims of these crimes. I would be deeply concerned that if these amendments were to be accepted, they could have a detrimental effect on victims by placing an unnecessary burden on them. In his letter of the 28th of April to the Justice Committee, the Lord Advocate set out three key concerns in relation to the use of a statutory defence. The first, was concerned that, as in the UK Modern Slavery Act and the equivalent Northern Ireland legislation, there would be a large number of exceptions for offences where the statutory offence could not apply. That would significantly restrict the protection for victims. Any decision made or approved by Parliament on the question of which offences are to be out with the scope of the defence may require to be reflected in the Lord Advocate's instructions as well. Secondly, the statutory offence would require evidence of a standard that could be presented at court for its application. And thirdly, and maybe most significantly, given our desire to take a victim-centred approach with this bill, the statutory defence would require the victim of human trafficking to do the work to establish this evidence themselves, requiring them to be proactive in providing information to their solicitor. Information of human trafficking is challenging, and victims may consider themselves to be victims, or the victims may not consider themselves to be victims. Equally, victims may be reluctant to disclose their status to the authorities through mistrust or fear of reprisal. It is therefore crucial that any mechanism to identify victims and prevent them from being prosecuted does not rely on disclosure by a victim themselves. If we imagine someone who has been rescued from the traumatic situation of having been trafficked and exploited, who may not be able to speak English and who may be unfamiliar with our legal system, why would we want to place a further burden on them in requiring them to raise a statutory defence? The use of Lord Advocate instructions will provide a flexible and comprehensive safeguard in relation to victims of human trafficking and exploitation who are compelled to commit offences by those who exploit them. Instructions will allow anyone, not only the victim, to bring forward evidence or intelligence that an alleged offender is a victim of human trafficking. I'm also concerned about the issue of time limits. A statutory defence would require to be raised in sufficient time so that the court is properly notified of the intention to rely upon it. Given the challenges involved in identification of victims in this area, delayed disclosure can be an issue, making strict time limits unrealistic, unhelpful, and potentially acting as a limit on the victim's access to protection. Instructions will apply at all stages of the criminal justice process. Even after someone has been convicted and sentenced for an offence, prosecutors may still consider information provided to them, and if it comes to light that the victim was compelled to commit the offence, then steps can be taken to have the conviction quashed. Instructions offer a flexible approach with no restriction on the type of information which prosecutors can consider when making decisions regarding the discontinuation of proceedings. This information could be in the form of intelligence, opinion evidence, hearsay evidence, evidence from other jurisdictions, or evidence reported by individuals who do not wish to provide a police statement or to be part of the criminal justice process. By contrast, as made clear by the Lord Advocate, reliance on statutory defence would require the defence to be supported by evidence which would be admissible under Scots law. Decisions will be made within the confines of the evidence presented during the trial, rather than with the benefit of all the information available, notwithstanding issues of admissibility. Now, some members may question why it's an either-or situation. Why could the bill not contain provisions for both statutory defence and Lord Advocate's instructions? In his letter of the 15th of June to the Justice Committee, the Lord Advocate made clear that if Parliament were to introduce a statutory defence in legislation, this would result in a two-tier system for potential victims. I quote from the Lord Advocate's letter of the 15th June to the committee. He stated, "My instructions would only apply post-conclusion of criminal proceedings, as a statutory defence would be the choice of Parliament in transposing the Human Trafficking Directive in domestic law in relation to the criminal proceedings. My instructions could only apply when the statutory defence was not available." Presiding Officer, the Government's preferred option is therefore to place a duty on the Lord Advocate to produce instructions to prosecutors to meet our victim-centred approach in this issue. And as I've made clear, this approach is the one supported by the Lord Advocate, who made the case against a statutory defence in the strongest possible terms, both in his oral evidence and in subsequent written correspondence to the Justice Committee. Now, therefore, urge Margaret Mitchell to withdraw Amendment 6 and not to move her other amendments.
Many thanks. I now call on Margaret Mitchell to wind up and press withdrawal amendment.
Right, thank you, Presiding Officer. The Lord Advocate has, as recently as today, in a letter dated 29th of September, written to the Justice Committee regarding its statutory defence and his instructions on the prosecution of victims of human trafficking or exploitation. In this, he infers that you can have either his instructions or a statutory defence. This is simply not the case. It was quite categorically stated in evidence from witnesses that you can have both. And that's where the argument that it's better to have a victim-centred approach advanced by both my colleagues Alison McInnes and John Finney falls down. I reiterate, the two are not mutually exclusive. You can have both, and this provides additional protection for victims for whom the Lord Advocate, without the statutory defence, is judge and jury. That's simply not fair. And it seems to me the most bizarre argument of all is the one that the Cabinet Secretary has just repeated, that it's an unnecessary burden on victims to have the additional protection of a safety net. How bizarre is that? This means that the Lord Advocate alone decides on the credibility and the reliability of the information to support the fact that an individual is trafficked. And in effect, if we vote down this amendment today, the individual is to be denied the protection of the statutory defence which is afforded them in England, in Wales and in Northern Ireland. I urge members to vote for this amendment and move it now.
Many thanks. And so the question is that Amendment 6 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not agreed. There will therefore be a division. Please vote now, and this will be a 60-second division. The result of the vote on Amendment number 6 is yes, 40, no, 70. There were no abstentions, and the amendment is therefore not agreed. Now move to Group 6, and I call Amendment 13 in the name of Jenny Mara, Group with Amendments 14, 15 and 16. Jenny Mara to move Amendment 13 and speak to all amendments in the group, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Amendments 13, which I now move, 14, 15 and 16, seek to strengthen the Section 8 provision of support to victims of trafficking. Presiding Officer, the policy memorandum states that the bill will ensure the rights of trafficked victims to access support and assistance, placing a duty on the Scottish Minister to secure the provision of relevant immediate support and recovery services for adult victims of trafficking. I am concerned, however, that Section 8 does not actually do what we think it does. Section 8 does not oblige ministers to provide immediate support for a person who identifies as a possible victim. Support is only guaranteed once a decision has been made that there are reasonable grounds to believe someone is a victim, which at present requires a decision under the national referral mechanism. Presiding officer, the first few hours and days of a person being identified as a possible victim can be the most traumatic. They may have taken the brave step of disclosing what has happened to them or have been found during police raids. In such moments, the offer of assistance should be automatic and guaranteed, not dependent on a discretionary provision. Amendment 13 will ensure that whenever there are sufficient signs a person may have been trafficked to lead to a referral into the National Referral Mechanism, then that person should have an immediate right to basic support and assistance from the moment that the referral is made. They should not have to wait for a reasonable grounds decision or a decision to exercise the discretionary power. This is putting bureaucracy ahead of human need. Each situation is, of course, different, and individuals that do not need or want support will not be obliged to accept it. Providing support from the point of referral is the approach that has been adopted in Northern Ireland, the only other part of the UK to have a statutory duty to provide trafficking victims with support. Presiding officer, I believe that we would be well to do the same. Amendment 14 addresses two other key problems with Section 8. Firstly, it will put into statute a minimum time of 45 days for which a victim is entitled to support. And secondly, it will ensure that victims who receive a positive, conclusive decision before the end of the support period will continue to be entitled to support. Consequential Amendment 15 removes the power to provide support on a discretionary basis, where that is superseded by the entitlement in Amendments 13 and 14, but retains the power to provide support on a discretionary basis beyond the time when the positive conclusive grounds decision remains. Presiding Officer, Amendment 16 introduces a requirement for the publication of guidance about the exercise of the power to provide victims with support on a discretionary basis. And I have already mentioned some of my concerns about relying on discretionary powers.
Many thanks. I now call on the Cabinet Secretary, Margaret Mitchell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Just to support Jenny Marrow's Amendment 16 requiring the Scottish Ministers to publish guidance on the provision and support of assistance to victims of an offence of human trafficking. And while I'm sympathetic to Amendment 13, because I do feel there is a real issue about the first hours that someone who is potentially trafficked and how they are dealt with, then I think there's some difficulty in just determining exactly what the sufficient signs would be. And I think Amendment 16 maybe covers things for the meantime and gives us an accurate reflection of how the discretionary power is working.
Many thanks. Now call the Cabinet Secretary.
President Officer, I welcome the opportunity to set out again the Scottish Government's position in relation to the issues raised by Jenny Mara and her amendments 13 to 16. Amendments 13 to 15 were considered but not accepted by the Justice Committee at Stage 2. We did not support these amendments at Stage 2 as they went against the Government's approach to providing for compulsory or discretionary support in Section 8 of the Bill. The Government's own amendment at Stage 2, which was accepted by the Committee, also provides further flexibility by allowing these issues to be considered and changed through regulations. The Government's position has not changed on these amendments since they were rejected at Stage 2. We still have significant concern that these amendments are too wide in the context of the Bill. For example, Amendment 13 would impose a duty to provide support where a reference is about to be made. That test is insufficiently clear to provide any sort of certainty to victims or support providers on when mandatory support duties will be triggered. In relation to the ending of the period of compulsory support and assistance, Amendment 14 seeks to ensure that a victim of Section 1 offence would receive support or assistance for a period of at least 45 days. We believe Jenny Mara's approach would severely restrict the government's ability to deal with any changes to the national referral mechanism process on which Section 8 of the bill relies. The Scottish Government's preferred approach here is to rely on regulation-making powers in Section 8.2 of the Bill to set out the period of support. The power added at Stage 2 and now in Section 8.8 of the Bill also allows ministers to adjust the way in which a conclusive determination is made. This allows the Government to take into account the outcome of the National Referral Mechanism pilots. These pilots are currently underway and looking at how the national referral mechanism can be streamlined and improved. The outcomes from these pilots will help establish the most effective approach going forward. Allowing the level of support and assistance to be determined under these regulations-making powers provides more flexibility to change the minimum or maximum period that support and assistance must be provided under the mandatory support provisions in Section 8.2. As background, the National Referral Mechanism Review was commissioned by the Home Secretary in April 2014. The review was asked to examine and make recommendations to the Home Secretary on six key areas: identification of victims, how they access support, the level of support that victims receive, decision-making, governance of the NRM and collection and sharing of data. The report of the review of the NRM recommended providing support based on an assessment of the individual's needs of the victim, and that consideration should be given to entry and exit timescales and support following conclusive identification. This chimes with the victim-centred approach that we want to take in this bill. Members will wish to be aware the review also recommended an overhaul of the referral process of the National Referral Mechanism. We believe that Section 8.3 of the Bill, as it stands, provides appropriate, flexible approach to discretionary support. Amendment 16 seeks to require ministers to publish guidance on that. We do not consider that a separate guidance document would be necessary or helpful in this context. I think we should be very cautious about setting out detailed guidance, as appears to be envisaged here, on the circumstances in which discretionary support is to be provided. This support must be directed towards the needs of the individual victims, and I would be concerned that lengthy guidance on the matter may in fact constrain the provision of that support rather than encourage it. I also do not think that Amendment 16 works well with Section 8 as it stands. For example, Amendment 16 suggests that guidance would cover an external authority making a determination about a discretionary support, when it is ministers who exercise the discretion to provide support under Section 8.3. It is also the case that, since the duty, the guidance issued is to a duty on Scottish ministers. This amendment would in effect amount to a requirement on ministers to issue guidance to themselves. Such guidance would, of course, have limited legal effect. Members will wish to be aware that Section 31(3)(c) of the Bill covers a strategy. This provision may, in particular, set out support and assistance which is or is to be available to adults or children who are or appear to be victims of an offence under this Act. General Officer, my officials plan to visit at least one of the pilot areas to find out how the pilots are progressing. On the back of that visit, I am happy to make an offer to Jenny Mara and to Christina McKelvey, who are co-conveners of the Cross-Party Group on Human Trafficking, that my officials will work with the group to get their input and views into this matter. We will carefully consider opinions on how to support, to offer support and assistance, and how that should be accessed, delivered and evaluated. And looking forward, we will of course also consult with key stakeholders on the drafting of these regulations. As such, I would urge Jenny Mara to withdraw Amendment 13 and not to move her other amendments.
Thank you very much. I now call on Jenny Marrow to wind up and press or withdraw your amendment.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome the Cabinet Secretary's commitment for the, his civil servants to engage with the cross-party group going forward, because indeed he knows as well as I do that today is the first step, this legislation, in our fight against human trafficking. But I do believe, Presiding Officer, that these amendments actually provide a lot of clarity, and I'm slightly surprised that the Minister thinks that actually putting some commitments into legislation could actually perhaps compromise or dissuade from support being given to trafficking victims. Presiding Officer, Section 8 is a central part of the bill, perhaps the most important part of this bill, and the needs and care of victims must remain a primary focus, not just of our laws here today, but the strategy and the ground level action that will follow. And it is an important marker that our legislation gives a statutory basis to victims' entitlement to support. And I believe that we need to make sure that these laws we pass here today do not shortchange the people and the guarantees people who are extremely vulnerable. I will press my amendments, Presiding Officer.
Many thanks. And so the question is that Amendment 13 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not. There will therefore be a division. Please vote now. This will be a 60-second division. The result of the vote on amendment number 13 is yes, 33, no, 77. There were no abstentions, and the amendment is therefore not agreed. I now call amendment 14 in the name of Jenny Marrow. Jenny Marrow, to move or not move?
Moved.
Many thanks. And so the question is that amendment 14 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not. There will therefore be a division. Please vote now. Result of the vote on amendment number 14 is yes, 37, no, 73, no abstentions, and the amendment is therefore not agreed. Now I call amendment 15 in the name of Jenny Marrow. Jenny Marrow, to move or not move?
Moved.
Many thanks. And the question is that amendment 15 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not. There will therefore be a division. Please vote now. Result of the vote, amendment number 15 is yes, 33, no, 77. There were no abstentions, and the amendment is therefore not agreed. Now call amendment 16 in the name of Jenny Marrow. Jenny Marrow, to move or not move?
Moved.
And so the question is that amendment 16 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not. There will therefore be a division. Please vote now. Result of amendment number 16 is yes 47, no 62. There were no abstentions and the amendment is therefore not agreed. Now move to group 7 and I call amendment 7 in the name of Christina McKelvey, grouped amendments 17 and 9. Christina McKelvey to move amendment 7 and speak to all other amendments in the group, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. In moving Amendment 7, firstly, I would like to thank the Cabinet Secretary, my parliamentary colleagues and all of the stakeholders who have helped develop the content of amendments on these issues. I would especially like to thank Lisa Gamble from Barnados, who has helped us all understand the particular challenges faced by children who are at risk or have been trafficked. Presiding Officer, this builds and strengthens what is a very important piece of work furthering the interests of vulnerable, unaccompanied, trafficked children in Scotland. This amendment, which reflects amendments which were lodged by Alistair MacInnes and Jenny Marra at Stage 2, seeks to broaden the pool of children who will be eligible to receive a guardian. This broadening of the criteria seeks to include those children who are at risk of and vulnerable to becoming a victim of trafficking, not merely children who are believed to have been trafficked already. At Stage 2, the Scottish Government did commit to working with the committee members and stakeholders to get a better understanding of who this cohort of children should be, and I believe they have done that. This amendment, as lodged, broadens the scope so that the provision of independent child trafficking guardians will now extend to children who are or might be a victim of trafficking, and crucially, Presiding Officer, who might be vulnerable to trafficking in the future. This will have the effect of protecting unaccompanied children where a determination of trafficking might not be immediately apparent, therefore giving those children the immediate support they need, and those unaccompanied children who simply through their own circumstances may find themselves very vulnerable to being trafficked.
Many thanks. I now call on Jenny Marra to speak to Amendment 17 and other amendments of the group, please.
Presiding Officer, I welcome Amendment 7 in the name of Christina McKelvey, which extends the provision of a guardian to other children vulnerable to trafficking. I'm grateful also to the Cabinet Secretary for listening to the concerns of those of us who tabled these amendments and pressed the issue at Stage 2. The Cabinet Secretary has moved a long way on this, from insisting that the named person was sufficient protection for trafficked children to the much more comprehensive amendment that Christina McKelvey has just moved today, giving a legal guardian to all separated migrant children, including EU migrant children. Presiding Officer, the migrant crisis we witness on our TV screens and the possibility of unaccompanied migrant children arriving in our communities becomes all the more real, and therefore the Cabinet Secretary's shift in thinking on this is very welcome today. I would, however, seek clarification about the terminology used in Amendment 7 to confirm that it will indeed ensure that all separated migrant children will receive a guardian under this section, and what criteria will be used to determine whether or not an individual child is vulnerable to becoming a victim. Presiding Officer, Amendment 17 in this group will provide the protection of a guardian for children whose parents are suspected of being involved in trafficking or exploiting their own children. The bill currently provides a guardian only for children who do not have anyone with parental rights and responsibilities in the UK. Now, this provision assumes that the parents of a child will act to support and protect a child's best interests in the way that a guardian would. Sadly, for some children, this is not the case, and they are actually exploited by their own parents. I believe that if we leave this clause as it stands, we are leaving some very vulnerable children potentially at risk by not providing them with a guardian. And I cannot think of a more vulnerable position for a child to be in than to be exploited by their own parents. Presiding Officer, in 1689, our Court of Session heard the case of the Tumbling Lassie, a little girl who was sold by her parents in this country into the circus. Our Court of Session just up the road deemed the sale of a person and child illegal in Scottish common law. But today, That awful situation where parents are suspected of exploitation still exists. Now, today, children would be removed from the parents' care for their protection, but I believe that is insufficient. We must make sure that these vulnerable children are given the same protection as unaccompanied children arriving on our shores. They should be given a legal guardian. However, I cannot see that Section 8B would allow the appointment of a guardian, and I would urge the Cabinet Secretary to complete the protection of children vulnerable to trafficking in this section by supporting Amendment 17.
Many thanks. I now call on the Cabinet Secretary to speak to Amendment 9 and other amendments of the group, please.
I'd like to thank both Christina McKelvey and Jenny Mara for their amendments. I'm fully supportive of Amendment 7 and its effect on widening the eligibility criteria to include those children who are unaccompanied and may be vulnerable to being trafficked. The services of a guardian, as currently provided for in the Bill, are for children who do not have anyone in the UK with parental rights and responsibilities. However, Amendment 17 seeks to widen the cohort of children who are eligible to be appointed a guardian to include children where a person who holds parental rights and responsibilities is not in regular contact or has a conflict of interest with the child. Child protection services, including the police and children and family social workers, amongst others, already have responsibility to work with children and anyone who holds parental rights and responsibilities in relation to them when this is in the best interest of the child. In the extremely serious situation where a person with parental rights and responsibilities has condoned or indeed been actively involved in the trafficking of a child, then child protection mechanisms are available to remove that child in order to protect them from harm. Local authorities also have wider responsibilities to any child in need or to children who are looked after where they are required to provide them with services and support, and where necessary, accommodation, in order to address the child's needs and to support them. This will be articulated in the strategy to be prepared under the Bill, where we will emphasise the existing support mechanisms and how they should be deployed to ensure the care and safety of trafficked children. I therefore want to make clear that through these existing mechanisms, all children, including those who are not eligible to receive a guardian as provided for in the Bill, will receive the support and protection they require. No child will be excluded, as we already have appropriate support in place through Scotland's highly regarded and widely experienced child protection workforce. The services of a guardian, as currently provided for in the Bill, are for children who do not have anyone in the UK with parental rights and responsibilities. Such children may require particular and specialist support, for example, for overcoming language barriers or obtaining legal services for an interview with the Home Office to determine their immigration status. I do not believe that it is necessary or appropriate to extend this provision to children who do not face the same set of challenges or who already have support via existing domestic measures. I therefore urge the Chamber to resist Amendment 17. I now turn to my own amendment, Amendment 9. This relates to an amendment from Alison MacInnes at Stage 2, resulting in the Bill now allowing relevant authorities to make a referral to appoint a guardian for a child. The Government's position at Stage 2 was that only local authorities should make such a referral. The list of relevant authorities in the Bill as a result of the Alison MacInnes amendments include local authorities, the police, health boards, the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service, and the UK Visa and Immigration Service. This list of bodies as set out by Alison MacInnes potentially raises some legislative competence issues in relation to the specification of the UK Visa and Immigration Service, which is part of the Home Office. It is also not appropriate to include the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service, as it is not a legal entity. Therefore, I recognise the point here, and that is why I have now brought forward Amendment 9. Amendment 9 amends the definition of relevant authorities in the Bill and gives ministers an enabling power by regulation to add to the list of relevant authorities proposed. This will allow time to consider which agencies over and above local authorities should be added as appropriate referring agencies. And I therefore ask members to support Amendment 7. Of course, I'll give way.
Member.
Mr. McInnes.
I recognise the points that you make about perhaps the legislative competence of including UK visas and immigration agency. Can I ask you, just to put on the record, that you recognise the need to consider that there will be other organisations that can refer to this system and perhaps indicate a timetable for the bringing forward of regulations?
Secretary.
Well, as I just outlined, the purpose for this enabling power and the regulations is to allow us to then consider what enabling authorities should be listed within that provision within the bill, which will achieve the objective that the member is seeking to achieve. The regulations relating to this bill will commence once the bill has actually been approved by Parliament, with the due consultation exercise that would normally surround such development of regulations. President Officer, I would therefore ask members to support Amendment 7 and 9 and to ask Jenny Mara not to move Amendment 17. However, if it is moved, I would urge members to resist Amendment 17.
Thanks very much. I now call on Alison McInnes.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I speak in support of Amendment 7. At stage 2, both Christina McKelvey and I think actually Jenny Mara also had something similar, and myself, all had amendments with similar intent to this, withdrawing at stage 2 to allow the government time to explore whether there was indeed a gap in provision. And I'm really pleased that the government has recognised the vulnerability of all unaccompanied children. When we spoke about it at stage 2, we felt there was a need to create a presumption that a child who is travelling alone and who seeks asylum might have been trafficked. And if we want all children who have been trafficked to be referred to the guardianship service, we must surely acknowledge that many separated children who present in the first instance as asylum seekers will subsequently be identified as having been trafficked. Those most vulnerable young people will present perhaps with a cover story, or they might not even understand that they have been trafficked, and they deserve the earliest possible intervention. We're talking about a small number of children who, as I said, might not realise they've been trafficked, and without this amendment passing today, there would be an increased risk that a child could be re-trafficked before they have been identified. So I will vote in support of that amendment. Turning briefly to Amendment 9, I recognise the issues relating to legislative competence, but it is important to recognise that there is merit in organisations having the capacity to refer a child to an independent guardian as soon as it is reasonably practical, after they've been given grounds to consider that the child may be a trafficking victim. Local authorities are not necessarily the first point of contact for a trafficked child, and I welcome the Cabinet Secretary's commitment to bring forward regulations on this.
Thanks so much. And I now call on Christina McKelvey to wind up and press the withdrawal amendments.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I think we need to be very careful about what language we use when we describe unaccompanied young children through this system, especially when we talk about the refugee crisis. It is not a migrant crisis, it is a refugee crisis, and we have to be very careful that we ensure that we describe these people as such. Presiding Officer, separated and unaccompanied children, as Alison McInnes has just said, are absolutely vulnerable. And this morning at the European and External Relations Committee, we heard from people who have just returned from Lesbos who say there's children there as young as 10 travelling on their own. They've been separated or they're unaccompanied, and some of them are being indentured into becoming traffickers themselves. So this is a huge issue if we give these young people the right support at the right time with the right guardian. Then we can maybe start breaking some of the cycle that happens in islands like Lesbos in Turkey and some of the refugee camps that are across the whole of Europe and beyond. On Amendment 9, Presiding Officer, I want to take up the Cabinet Secretary's request that we get involved in this. I think it's extremely important that all children receive the support and protection that they so justly require, and a multi-agency approach has always been the best at doing that. And I think when we're looking at enabling authorities to become, you know, those eligible people, then we should look at the process that we have right now for first responders through the children's hearing system, ensuring that the best holistic approach is given to that young person for all of the reasons that I've just explained.
Many thanks. And so the question is that Amendment 7 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are. Thank you very much. I call Amendment 17 in the name of Jenny Mara. Jenny Mara, to move or not move?
Moved.
And so the question is that Amendment 17 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not. There will therefore be a division, and this will be a 1 minute division.
Result of the vote on amendment number 17 is yes 44, no 62. There were no abstentions and the amendment is therefore not agreed. Now move to group 8 and I call amendment 18 in the name of Jenny Mara, grouped with amendments 8, 19 and 20. Jenny Mara to move amendment 18 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Presiding Officer, Amendment 18, which I now move, corrects a weakness in Section 8B by providing statutory authority for the Guardian's functions. Section 8B7 contains an enabling power which makes it possible for the Scottish Government to create regulations about a number of detailed aspects of the Guardian system, including the Guardian's functions. I welcome the commitment to making regulations made by the Cabinet Secretary at Stage 2 in response to an amendment I tabled, which would have turned the power into a requirement. However, as I have mentioned, the power in Section 8B7 enables ministers to bring forward regulations on a number of different elements of the guardianship scheme, and the Cabinet Secretary has not specifically committed to bringing forward regulations about the guardian functions. Let me explain why I am highlighting this aspect. In order for the guardians to be effective in supporting children, they need to have a degree of authority. Their role and position needs to be understood and respected by other professionals working with the child. This is already recognised by subsection 6, which requires anyone exercising statutory duties in relation to a child who has a guardian under this legislation to recognise and pay due regard to the guardian's functions. But without those functions being clearly articulated and given statutory authority, meeting this requirement becomes much more complicated. Putting the functions of the guardian in statute will facilitate smooth and effective cooperation between the guardian and other professionals and other agencies working with the child. It is for reasons like this that the EU Fundamental Rights Agency Handbook on Guardianship for Trafficked Children recommends national law should provide the legal basis of guardianship and define the authority responsible for it. The legal basis of guardianship in national law should include sufficiently precise legal provisions defining a guardian's duty and functions. Presiding Officer, as it stands, Section 8B does not contain precise provisions defining the guardian's duty and functions, nor does the enabling power guarantee creation of regulations meeting this requirement. Presiding Officer, the Modern Slavery Act 2015, which provides advocates for trafficked children and which must await the outcome of trials before this help is available, even that Act more widely meets this requirement. The Modern Slavery Act states specifically that the function of the advocate must be set in regulations. Northern Ireland's legislation goes further, setting out the functions of independent guardians in the primary legislation. I think it would be a great shame to finish this process with a weaker statutory framework than the rest of the UK, after Scotland led the way by introducing the Scottish Guardianship Service several years ago. I recognise that there are some benefits of flexibility that regulations provide. Amendment 19 in my name also in this group provides this flexibility by including a power for the Scottish Government to add to the list of guardians' functions through subsequent regulations. This allows any additional responsibilities that are considered necessary in future to be added to the guardian role simply. The essential functions of the guardian included in Amendment 18 are based on those of the Northern Ireland legislation, which was recommended as a model by expert groups such as the Scottish Guardianship Service and ECPAT UK during Stage 1. The functions also reflect the responsibilities recommended in guidelines from international expert bodies, including the EU Fundamental Rights Agency handbook I have just referred to, but also guidelines produced by UNICEF and the United Nations. These functions are not a dramatic departure from those of the Scottish Guardianship Service, which already operates in line with international principles. Presiding Officer, Amendment 20, also in this group, amends Section 37 to require any regulations laid under this clause about the functions of the guardian, that is, whether regulations about functions under the existing power or regulations about further functions under Amendment 19 to be made by the affirmative procedure and will ensure that Parliament is able to offer scrutiny of any functions proposed for the guardian role. This will help ensure that the guardians have the necessary responsibilities to provide an effective support to children and that the role incorporates all the expert recommendations of international best practice.
Many thanks. And I now call Cabinet Secretary to speak to Amendment 8 and other amendments in the group, please.
Signed officer, I will first speak to my own amendments in this group before dealing with Jenny Mara's amendments 18 to 20. Stakeholders' views are that guardians will be best able to carry out their role by having access to as much relevant information as possible about the child. Section 8B6 of the Bill currently provides that any person providing services or taking decisions in relation to a child for whom a guardian has been appointed must recognise and pay due regard to the independent child trafficking guardian's function. My Amendment 8 amends Section 8B to also oblige such persons to provide the independent child trafficking guardian with access to such information relating to the child as will enable the guardian to carry out those functions effectively, and I'd ask members to support Amendment 8. Jenny Mara's amendments also deal with functions. Amendment 18 seeks to put certain functions of the guardian on the face of the bill. Making this provision without proper consultation with stakeholders does involve significant risk. It was for this reason that we wanted to make legislative provision on guardians through regulations to be made under the bill. By specifying the functions in regulations rather than on the face of the bill, we will have the opportunity to consult with and involve stakeholders who will work with these children to properly identify what the functions of the guardian will be. This will help to ensure that we get the secondary legislation in this area absolutely right. It also gives us the flexibility to add to or amend the functions as needed in order to take account of any emerging changes. The strategy being prepared in connection with the bill can help to reinforce this legislation by also referencing the functions. Our approach, therefore, Presiding Officer, seeks to ensure that the functions that are identified will be made via legislation based on consultation and evidence and will therefore be relevant to the guardians to ensure the guardian is able and to undertake their role effectively. For the reasons I have set out, I do not support Amendment 18 and the relevant amendments in 19 and 20, and would encourage Jenny Mara to withdraw Amendment 18. However, if pressed, I would urge members to reject Amendment 18, 19 and 20, but to support Amendment 8 in my name.
Many thanks. Jenny Mara, to wind up and press a withdrawal?
Nothing further, and I'll press.
Thanks. And so the question is that Amendment 18 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not agreed. There will therefore be a division. This will be a 60-second division. Please vote now. The result of the vote on Amendment number 18 is yes 42, no 63. There were no abstentions, and the amendment is therefore not agreed. I now call Amendment 8 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary. Cabinet Secretary to move.
Moved.
Many thanks. The question is that Amendment 8 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. Thank you. Call Amendment 19 in the name of Jenny Mara. Jenny Mara to move or not?
Moved.
Many thanks. The question is that Amendment 19 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are not. There will therefore be a division, a 30-second division. Please vote now. Of the vote and amendment number 19 is yes 41, no 65. There were no abstentions, and the amendment is therefore not agreed. Now call amendment 9 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary. Cabinet Secretary to move.
Moved.
And the question is that amendment 9 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. Thanks very much. We now move to group 9, and I call amendment 10 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary in a group on its own. Cabinet Secretary to move and speak to amendment 10, please.
At stage 2, Alison McInnes put forward an amendment which looked to put a timescale on of a maximum of 1 year between the commencement of Part 1 and 2 of the Bill and the publication of the Trafficking and Exploitation Strategy. Whilst I was happy to commit to publish the strategy within a suitable timeframe and supportive of the intention behind the amendment to make sure there was no unnecessary delay in the publication of this important document, I had some minor concerns about the amendment as it stood at stage 2. I therefore agreed to bring forward an amendment at stage 3, which would require publication of the first strategy to take place quickly. I considered a number of options as to the timescale, and I'm of the view that linking the deadline for publication of the strategy to the commencement of Section 1 best delivers what Alison McInnes wished to see. The commencement of Section 1 will bring the offence of human trafficking into being and is the logical basis for the clock to start running on the requirement to publish the strategy, and I therefore move Amendment 10.
Many thanks. And so the question is that Amendment 10 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. Many thanks. Now call Amendment 11 in the name of Margaret Mitchell. Margaret Mitchell to move or not move?
Not moved.
Many thanks. And so I now call Amendment 20 in the name of Jenny Mara. Jenny Mara to move or not?
Moved.
Many thanks. So the question is Amendment 20 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not. There will therefore be a division. Please vote now. This will be a 60-second division. The result of the vote on amendment number 20 is yes 42, no 64. There were no abstentions, and the amendment is therefore not agreed. I now call amendment 21 in the name of Rhoda Grant. Rhoda Grant to move or not move?
Not moved.
Thank you. And so I now call amendment 22 in the name of Margaret Mitchell. Margaret Mitchell to move or not move?
Not moved.
Thank you very much. And that ends considerations of amendments. And we now move to the next item of business, which is a debate on motion number 14421 in the name of Michael Matheson on human trafficking and exploitation. Scotland Bill. I'd invite members who wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible, and I call on Michael Matheson to speak to and move the motion. Cabinet Secretary, you have 10 minutes, please.
Presiding Officer, I'm pleased to open the Stage 3 debate on the Human Trafficking and Exploitation Scotland Bill. I'd like to begin by thanking the members and clerks of the Justice Committee, Finance Committee and the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee for their consideration of the bill. I also want to thank external stakeholders who have engaged in the bill process and have helpfully taken the time to share their knowledge and expertise. I also thank the Information Commissioner for Scotland for his assistance and kind offer to work with my officials, if Parliament agrees to pass this legislation, to develop regulations, guidance and a privacy impact assessment. This will help to ensure information sharing under the terms of the bill will be carried out appropriately and firmly within the perimeters of data protection law. Senior Officer, the Justice Committee invited a wide range of stakeholders to give evidence at Stage 1. That evidence, as well as the Justice Committee's Stage 1 report, which supported the general principles of the bill, proved to be extremely helpful in assisting government to carefully reflect on how the bill could be refined and enhanced. Stage 2 resulted in a number of improvements to the bill and also provided us with some food for thought ahead of Stage 3. The bill will clarify and strengthen the criminal law by introducing a new comprehensive single human trafficking offence. The new offence increases the maximum penalty for offenders to life imprisonment. The bill gives Scotland's law enforcement agencies further tools in their locker to bring about those responsible for human trafficking and exploitation to justice, and this enables them to prevent the commissioning of these grave offences through enhanced forfeiture and detention powers, new trafficking and exploitation prevention and risk orders. The bill ensures adult victims of trafficking will now have a statutory entitlement to support and assistance that meets their individual's needs, which may include, amongst other things, accommodation, medical advice and treatment, and legal advice. Scottish ministers will be under an obligation to work with other bodies to publish and keep under review a Scottish trafficking and exploitation strategy focusing on matters such as awareness raising, prevention and detection of trafficking and exploitation, and the support available to victims of these offences. Research from the National Crime Agency Human Trafficking Centre estimates that there are 13,000 potential victims of slavery in the UK. This bill deals with labour exploitation of the most serious kind and is supplemented by the UK-wide Transparency and Supply Chain provisions in Section 54 of the Modern Slavery Act 2015, on which we work closely with the UK Government. Beyond this, exploitation for the purposes of human trafficking offence covers a wide range of exploitative conduct. We are aware that some stakeholders express concern at Stage 1 that children are not named on the face of the bill. The majority of provisions within the bill equally apply to adults and child victims of trafficking. However, it should be noted that those provisions relating to support for victims are explicitly aimed at providing a statutory basis for the support and assistance of adult victims of trafficking. This is because the necessary support for children who may be victims of trafficking is already enshrined in legislation which provides for all vulnerable children. We welcomed and supported the amendments from Alison MacInnes at Stage 2 that added an aggravation for the offence of human trafficking where a child is involved. We also supported Christina McKelvey's amendments at Stage 2 that placed a duty on Scottish ministers to make such arrangements as they consider reasonable to enable an independent child trafficking guardian to be appointed to assist, support and represent a child where it is reasonably believed that the child may have been the victim of human trafficking. We supported these amendments because we know that there is little, if anything, more despicable than the deliberate exploitation of children. And it's often the most vulnerable who suffer the most. In contrast, We want to create a society in which all children and young people have the right to be cared for and protected from harm and can grow up in a safe environment. Child victims of trafficking are supported within the well-established system we have in place in Scotland to support our most vulnerable children. We are absolutely clear that the primary responsibility for child victims of trafficking should remain firmly within the child protection framework. That framework embodies the key principles of GIRFIC, which, as early intervention and wellbeing are key factors. We believe that this is the most effective way to support the recovery of children and young people who have been traumatised. This bill provides introduces two duties for the provision of a guardian for eligible children. There is a duty on ministers to ensure that there is a guardian service available, and the second duty is on relevant authorities to refer the child to the guardian. On referral, the child is appointed a guardian who will represent a point of contact and expertise for them. As these children are unaccompanied, that is, that there is no one with parental rights and responsibilities for them in the UK, the role of that guardian will be to provide them with a level of acceptance and guidance which will help them in a very difficult set of circumstances. The role of the guardian will be to advise on all sorts of matters, for instance, to make the young person aware of their rights and explain aspects of the asylum, trafficking and welfare system to them. They will also introduce them to social opportunities to help them begin to reintegrate into community life. By creating these two duties and by not putting the guardianship service itself on a statutory footing, the guardian can act in the best interests of the child first, putting them and not the process to which the statutory body would be bound to at the centre of the service. We amended the bill at stage two to ensure that victims of trafficking whose age is uncertain but who appear to be children are presumed to be children for the purposes of receiving immediate age-appropriate support and services until their age is formally established. At a time when many children across the world are being displaced as a result of conflict, poverty and persecution, and may fall with a victim to trafficking or exploitation, it seems timely that we are taking these steps to further support young victims of trafficking in Scotland. However, we all know that legislation alone is not the answer to tackling this issue. The Government's programme for Scotland for 2015-16 set out our commitment to work with key agencies to develop a human trafficking and exploitation strategy for Scotland. I can provide the Chamber with an assurance that dialogue with stakeholders will continue as we develop our strategic approach in taking forward the development of the strategy. Human trafficking and exploitation is a brutal form of organised crime in which adults and children are treated as commodities and ruthlessly exploited for criminal gain, and there is no place for it in a modern Scotland. Presiding Officer, I move that Parliament agrees the Human Trafficking and Exploitation Scotland Bill be passed.
Many thanks. I now call on Jenny Mara. 7 minutes, please, Ms Mara.
Presiding Officer, as a Parliament and this Government, we have travelled far over the last 4 years, from human trafficking being a crime that not many people in this building talked about, to vastly increase political and public awareness of this heinous crime in Scotland. The bill, soon to become law this afternoon, has been instrumental in this process. There are many people who have played a key role in that, and I would like to put on record my personal thanks to some of them today. Graeme O'Neill, Ross McKenzie, Brona Andrews, the cross-party group on human trafficking, the civil servants and the minister for taking the bill through its last stages. I say last stages because this bill has been nearly 4 years in the making. It dates back to Baroness Selina Kennedy's inquiry into human trafficking in Scotland, which was published in November 2011. Helena Kennedy's report contained 10 key recommendations to tackle the crime of trafficking in Scotland, many of which can be found in the bill that we passed this afternoon. Following an extensive and comprehensive consultation, we found ourselves with over 50,000 responses to the bill, the third highest in the history of this Parliament. Such was the public interest in this campaign that the number of public responses was eclipsed only by two previous pieces of legislation, equal marriage and the smoking ban in public places. For mobilising public interest, I must put on record my thanks to ECPAT, CARE and Walk Free, and the Scottish churches in particular, who any campaign organisations should look to for examples of excellence in public campaigning. And, Presiding Officer, I also acknowledge the sustained reporting of the trafficking issue from the Scottish media, who have taken their responsibility for shining a light on dark corners of our nation very seriously throughout this campaign, on a story which is often not easy to report. So vulnerable are the victims, it is extremely difficult, if not impossible, for them to tell their story in a public forum. And it is for this reason, Presiding Officer, that I have never met a victim of human trafficking. But it is my duty, and the duty of everyone in this Parliament, to speak up for the voiceless and to use the powers of this place to improve our society and constantly make our communities more resilient against gendered, exploitative and violent crime, and to constantly strengthen the resolve for human rights respect across this country. Presiding Officer, I think this bill turned our current political narrative about powers on its head, because this bill starts from the premise that only by making our communities robust against the crime of trafficking at the grassroots will we combat this crime. Trafficking is an international crime motivated by vast profits. Criminal gangs will always find ways to get people into host countries, and they will be steps ahead of law enforcement agencies to do so. So it was never good enough to lay blame squarely at the door of the border agency and dismiss trafficking as an immigration problem. That is why this bill has taken the approach that if you strengthen communities against the crime, then Scotland becomes an unwelcome place for the crime of trafficking. Victims are more easily identified, intelligence to catch traffickers improves, and our police, legal and court systems know how to deal with the people responsible. Are we at that stage yet? I don't believe we are, because today is not the end of a process, it is simply the first day in our fight against trafficking in Scotland. We know that law is not enough, because, Presiding Officer, we have another human rights law in this country, that female genital mutilation is a crime. Yet there has not been one police report or prosecution of FGM in Scotland, but we do know that it is happening in our communities. And that is why it was critical in the Human Trafficking and Exploitation Bill to pave the path of the future. Legislation is never enough. The bill includes a duty upon the Scottish Government to publish a three-yearly anti-slavery strategy. I hope that this strategy will include training for our doctors, our nurses and our health professionals to teach them how to recognise a potential victim of trafficking when they present themselves. We know that trafficking victims rarely self-identify through fear of their own safety and fear of reprisals on their families back home. I want social workers to be trained so that they too, when working with vulnerable people, can identify and also know what resources are in their hands to help them. I'd like to see the crime of human trafficking taught in criminal law courses in our universities so that our lawyers of the future, when they are marking cases, can recognise a crime of human trafficking when presented with the evidence. I want our police officers, not just Borders Police, but police in every community across Scotland, to have an understanding of this crime so they can see it, investigate it and refer it up through our legal system. Only when communities are robust like this will the traffickers take note and consider Scotland too risky a place for their crime and human rights abuses. Presiding Officer, I understand that the Scottish Government already have civil servants working on this strategy. I hope some of my suggestions can be taken on board, but I would also like the Minister to clarify today how the strategy will be delivered, who will coordinate it, and will there be a group accountable to the Scottish Government that are leading it? More detail on this would be welcome today or in the near future. Presiding Officer, this morning I met women in the Trafficking Awareness Raising Alliance in Glasgow, who work every day supporting victims of human trafficking. Their working day today will be the same as yesterday and tomorrow, supporting women whose harrowing experiences we can only imagine. But today enshrines the support that they give into a right that can be expected in our country. It is the civilised thing to do, for our country to marshal the resources to look after vulnerable people. Today gives legal guardians to children who have been trafficked. Today strengthens our law and increases sentences for criminal traffickers. Today, most importantly, reiterates our resolve to protect and guard human rights in Scotland. It is a proud day for the Scottish Parliament and for our mission as public servants to shine a light in the dark corners of the world to bring hope and respect to those who need it.
Thank you. I now call in Margaret Mitchell. 5 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I very much welcome the fact that we're debating stage three of this important Human Trafficking and Exploitation Scotland Bill. I thank the Justice Committee convener, clerks and members for their hard work, and in particular I want to pay tribute to the evidence from witnesses at stage one. There is no doubt that this is a far better bill, having benefited from their experience and expertise on the front line. A case in point is the new definition of trafficking in Section 1, which is phrased now in such a way that there can be no ambiguity that the offence of trafficking can happen within as well as out with the country. The Lord Advocate was reluctant to accept that the previous definition was open to interpretation, and therefore pleased that the Cabinet Secretary has listened to the wise comments of those giving evidence on this point. I also want to acknowledge and thank Jenny Mara for the crucial part she has played in ensuring that we now have legislation in Scotland aimed at bringing trafficking to an end. Without her persistence, I don't believe we would be voting to pass this bill this evening. Presiding Officer, this bill becomes all the more pertinent given the now sadly all too familiar and harrowing refugee crisis, an issue which is increasingly dominating the minds of not just politicians in Scotland, the UK or even the EU, but on a global basis. I'm pleased that today we have passed the amendment in Christina McKelvey's name, which extends the provisions of a guardian to other children vulnerable to trafficking. Of the thousands of refugees and migrants now travelling in horrendous circumstances to Europe, it is estimated that one in four of these people are children who are not accompanied by an adult. These same children are being targeted by traffickers. So, in these circumstances, it is essential that we do absolutely everything we can to give them the protection they both need and have a right to expect. This makes the ability to provide them with a guardian all the more pressing. However, it is particularly depressing, Presiding Officer, that the Government has chosen to vote down my amendment, which would have provided these young people with an additional protection in the form of a statutory defence. This would have been over and above the presumption against prosecution and the instructions issued by the Lord Advocate. As a consequence, an opportunity has been missed to ensure that vulnerable young children and people have maximum protection in this bill, or even the same protection they will enjoy under the trafficking legislation in England and Wales and Northern Ireland. Turning now to Rhoda Grant's amendments in relation to the criminalisation of the purchase of sex discussed at stage two. As I said at that time, I don't believe that this bill affords the proper time to take evidence on this important issue. So whilst I had some sympathy with the amendment she lodged today at stage three regarding research, I believe more generally that the forthcoming Abusive Behaviour and Sexual Harm Bill would present an excellent opportunity to consult widely on this issue and to ensure the necessary scrutiny has been carried out. So I hope, therefore, that Rhoda Grant and Scottish ministers can work together to achieve this aim. Finally, the Cabinet Secretary, you may recall that stage one I raised the issue of the UK government's pilot into how the national referral mechanism is working regionally. The two pilot areas for these were Cornwall and West Yorkshire, and understand from the Scottish Government's response that Scotland wasn't included because there weren't sufficient numbers to make the pilot viable. However, he did, and you did, undertake at that time to get some more details from the Home Office. And given the number of cannabis farms being discovered on practically a daily basis and the link between cannabis workers and trafficking, I wonder if he could provide an update on this particular issue in his closing remarks. I confirm, Presiding Officer, that the Scottish Conservatives will be voting for the bill this evening.
Many thanks, and we now turn to the open debate, speeches of 4 minutes, and I call Christina McKelvey to be followed by Rhoda Grant.
Presiding Officer, thank you very much. It is a real privilege to be speaking in this debate today, but we wouldn't be here today if it wasn't for the many, many groups and individuals, the cross-party group, all of them. There's many, a few of them sitting in the gallery today who have pushed us along, encouraged us along, educated us and supported us to bring us to where we are today. And of course, Jenny Mara kicked off some of this with her bill, and we are really happy to have worked together to get to this point. Presiding Officer, today at lunchtime, Jenny Mara and I collected a petition from ECPAT, Walk Free and Care. And at that point today, there was over 6,000 signatures on the petition. And we were very happy to go out and get this petition, because what it demonstrated very clearly is people right across the whole of the UK support the aims of this bill, especially when it comes to protecting children. And I hope the Cabinet Secretary will accept this copy that I have of the petition at the end of the debate today on behalf of those groups who have taken it forward. Presiding Officer, the horrific crime of human trafficking is sometimes called modern day slavery. The exploitation of humans, women, men, and most disturbingly children is one of the most disgusting crimes. And yes, today we make that practice a crime. And we came about this, as I say, from a truly cross-party process, and we've all worked to ensure that this piece of legislation is the best piece of legislation, and I thank my colleagues for that cross-party support. Presiding Officer, today at the European and External Relations Committee, we had a roundtable about the refugee crisis in Europe and wider places, and Alison Phipps, who is from Gramnet at Glasgow University, told us this morning that some children, unaccompanied children as young as 10, are being indentured by trafficking gangs. They're being indentured and they're then being forced, some of the age of 14, 15, 16, some 16-year-olds, they're given keys to a boat and a gun and told to load up some people and make that treacherous journey across the Mediterranean. And it's that point where we come to this, where we understand, you know, that the organisation of this, but the actual impact on people is huge. So what we potentially have in this system is young people who have been trafficked, who are indentured to these gangs, who then subsequently become traffickers themselves. And that's where parts of this legislation become very, very, very important, when we describe those young people as victims and not as the criminals. And that's part of the Lord Advocate's guidance, and I really welcome that. That current refugee crisis creates so many opportunities for those traffickers. But this isn't a new thing. but it's something I think we will see a huge amount of over the next few months when we start to accept some of the people that we should be accepting, far more than the 20,000 I suspect that the UK government want to go with. And I would commend to my colleagues in the chamber, finally, to watch a film that we screened in this place called Nefarious Merchants of Souls, and you will then truly understand how organised this crime is and how absolutely horrific this crime is. Presiding Officer, I'm very, very happy that we managed to strengthen the bill today to protect children, to bring in child guardians. It is a furrow that I have been ploughing long before I was an elected politician as being a member of the Glasgow campaign to welcome the refugees in a unison steward. Presiding Officer, today at 5 o'clock when we press our buttons, and we pass lots of legislation in this place, and most times, you know, we're very, very pleased about it. But today, what we do is we create a system where we say, traffickers, you are not welcome. Scotland is closed. Trafficked people, especially children, this is your sanctuary. We will help you make this your home. And I really look forward to working with all of my colleagues across the chamber and all of my colleagues in Civic Scotland to make sure that we bring about the best strategy. So the Minister or the Cabinet Secretary may think that this is the end of a process. As Jenny said, it is for some of us, it's just the start, and we're really looking forward to working with them to bring about the best strategy, to give the best support and the best protection. Thank you.
Many thanks. I now call Rhoda Grant to be followed by Alison McInnes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's almost 200 years since we thought we'd abolished slavery, yet today we're passing legislation to tackle modern-day slavery, human trafficking. And can I start by paying tribute to Jenny Mara, who was the first to raise this issue in the Parliament and pressed forward with a member's bill. She has to take much of the credit for what we have in front of us today in the form of this bill. I also want to pay tribute to the many organisations, groups and individuals who have campaigned for this day as well. The Scottish Government, who recognised the importance of the issue and took over the bill, hence today we're voting on government legislation. It's impossible to imagine what it's like to be trafficked. Some people are literally abducted, others believe they're being assisted towards a new life and are duped into becoming victims. For others, they are groomed to an extent where they believe they're acting on their own free will, working to pay off debts incurred for being smuggled into the country. And this makes them really vulnerable because they believe they're in control of their own destiny, and indeed they themselves are the ones committing the crime. It'll take a long time to win their trust and confidence to an extent that they'll accept help and support. As we legislate for one form of human exploitation, others tend to raise their head. Of late, we've heard about people smugglers, those who prey on the desperation of refugees fleeing for their lives. Many of those people are not poor. They have money to pay the smugglers who take them on a hazardous journey. The risks are testament to the difficulties they face at home. And while this bill does not deal with these issues, we need a global solution that is compassionate and practical to help people in those situations. Due to the risks taken, many children and young people may be left fleeing alone because their parents are killed, and they are often the target of traffickers who are ready to prey on them in that situation. I've said before, I'm disappointed that the Scottish Government has not strengthened the bill with regard to people trafficked for sexual exploitation, and this is one of the main focuses for traffickers. It's a hugely lucrative business because those being exploited can be sold again and again. It's only by tackling prostitution and sexual exploitation with regard to the whole of the population that we'll be able to make this trade less attractive to traffickers. That said, the bill does cover much in the region of sexual exploitation and the industry as it stands, albeit that it doesn't deal with the market for exploitation or indeed the complex assistance required for victims. The bill is not limited to trafficking from abroad. It covers trafficking everywhere. For example, in places like Rotherham, where young women were trafficked and exploited within the city boundaries. There are powers, if used properly, which can offer protection and redress to those who are exploited within their own towns and cities, as well as those who come from abroad. The bill is specific that trafficking can take place within the UK. With regard to prostitution, Section 3(3) of the Bill states, another person exercises control, direction or influence over prostitution by the person in a way that shows that the other person is aiding, abetting or compelling prostitution. Many of the people in prostitution or who have exited tell me that that was the circumstances in which they were held, and therefore I hope that this bill will go some way into offering them protection. The police, who have led the way in fighting violence against women, will have an additional tool to use to do this. I wish that the Scottish Government would show vision on this issue. And that said, I sincerely hope that the work being carried out now by the Scottish Government leads to Scotland becoming a less attractive place for traffickers. Presiding Officer, the bill we're passing today will make a huge difference to the lives of the most vulnerable in our society. I want to congratulate Jenny Mara for instigating this process and recommend the bill to the Chamber.
Many thanks. I now call Alison McInnes to be followed by Sandra White.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I too would like to start by commending Jenny Mara on her drive and her determination on this issue. We mustn't forget that our private members' bill consultation laid the foundations for this government bill. But Christina McKelvey is right to point to the cross-party support and determination in this chamber too. Human trafficking is not new, but it is now the fastest growing international crime. The Equalities and Human Rights Commission report of 2011 was the catalyst for action to tackle human trafficking through a coherent legislative framework. That report exposed the grim truth about trafficking in Scotland. It shocked us all. At the time, Caleanna Lyle, EHRC Scotland Commissioner, said, and I quote, "Human trafficking is one of the most severe human rights abuses in the modern world. It operates below the radar and is kept there through fear and deception. The experiences of those who are trafficked here are often nothing short of brutal, and in the main, they are carefully hidden from society. The responsibility for tackling trafficking should be shared across agencies, with governments, and with society itself." End quote. Many victims are exploited in the sex industry, but also in fruit-picking farms or in the hospitality industry, or forced to live in brutal conditions as domestic servants. It occurs throughout Scotland and is not confined to its major cities. The bill, as originally introduced, failed to recognise the acute vulnerability of child victims of trafficking. The bill did not contain a definition of a child, nor did it specify the support they would be entitled to. The government has shown a willingness to listen to those of us who have campaigned on these issues and has largely either supported amendments by Jenny Mara, Christina McKelvey and myself, or supported the intention behind our amendments and brought forward government amendments today. And there is no doubt that the bill in its final form is much improved. It now includes statutory guardianship services, recognition that other relevant authorities have a role in referrals to those services, and the provision of guardianship not just to identified victims of trafficking, but to those who are vulnerable and may have been trafficked, but whose status is still in question. During the earlier stages of the passage of this bill, with support from Aberlour and Bernardo's, I highlighted the importance of creating such a presumption, so I'm particularly pleased that the Scottish Government reconsidered its position on this, meaning all unaccompanied children will now have an independent guardian. It's right to pay tribute to the Scottish Refugee Council in Aberlour for pioneering the Scottish Guardianship Service and proving its worth. In just 5 years, it has helped over 70 children and young people who have been victims of human trafficking. The bill now also provides for statutory aggravation in sentencing for a trafficking offence involving a child, and a presumption of age which ensures that if a person is detained and there are reasonable grounds to believe the person may be a child, that they would receive the type of support a child would get until their age is confirmed. And I also support the further changes today that now ensure that the evidential test within the Lord Advocate's instructions for the prosecution of child victims is different and simpler. This bill is an important step on the road to making Scotland a no-go area for human trafficking, but there are many more steps we will have to take together as a society if we are to end these brutal human rights abuses. Today, coincidentally, the historical child abuse inquiry starts its work. That addresses a monumental failure to understand and to take action. Over and over, we have missed human rights abuses going on in our midst. We struggled in the past to admit that such dreadful crimes as child sexual abuse, domestic abuse or grooming could be committed. And that's why traffickers are today getting away with it. There is still little public awareness of this crime. We need to get so much better at looking and listening to what is going on in our midst and in the margins. The Scottish Liberal Democrats will support this bill today.
Many thanks. I now call Sandra White to be followed by Malcolm Chisholm.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And I think it was Rhoda Grant that mentioned the fact that slavery, we thought it was abolished 250 years ago. This is a modern day type of slavery and something which obviously has to be tackled. And that's why I do welcome the bill. And I do particularly welcome the bill and the strategy, which I think we've heard places a duty on ministers to develop and keep the strategy under review. And Graham O'Neill from the Scottish Refugee Council was absolutely right when he said the strategy will be the vehicle for the long-term approach we need if we are going to tackle such a severe crime and human rights violation. And I do highlight the fact that Graham is absolutely right when he mentions about the severe crime and violates human rights. And it takes many forms. Human trafficking takes many forms. I've heard today in regards to that. Certainly, Jenny Marrow had mentioned she had met a victim of human trafficking. Certainly, I have met a victim of human trafficking, perhaps not in the way that a lot of people explain it, but this particular person was brought into the country under false pretences, passport taken from him, and moved from house to house. I wouldn't say what type of industry he worked in, but certainly did work in the service industry, put it that way. And very, very difficult for him and his family, who are still abroad, having no passport, having very little wages. Most of his salary was taken from him to supposedly pay for his rent, which was in a cramped room of something like 10 people and a bed on the floor. So I think we have to be absolutely correct in saying that it does take in all sorts and all forms human trafficking. I do want to pick up on what Christina McKelvey said and actually echo the comments that she mentioned in regard to Alison Phipps' comments. Alison gave a very powerful speech on Tuesday night at the meeting I mentioned earlier in the debate we had, the members' debate this afternoon, where she absolutely put forward that issue about 10-year-olds having to be, not having to, but being exploited by these traffickers who are using this now situation of refugees basically to exploit very, very vulnerable children. I just want to touch, when I've got the time left, on Rhoda Grant's amendment. Now, I was on the Justice Committee at the very beginning, haven't been on for the Stage 2, but my understanding was that there was no evidence taken in Stage 2 in regarding this particular amendment. And if you do look at the amendment which is before us today, actually, you know, Rhoda Grant's amendment mentions the fact that to introduce legislation to criminalise the purchase of sexual services. Well, when you look at that, you're not actually introducing an amendment, you're actually introducing a whole new bill into one particular act. And whilst I do sympathise with Rhoda, and I did have meetings along with her in various groups as well, I don't think this is the proper vehicle to go through, but I'll give way to Rhoda Grant.
Rhoda Grant.
Just on a point of clarification, the amendment allows for government to report back. It doesn't ensure that they have to put forward legislation, as you suggested.
Sandra White.
Well, perhaps I'm reading it wrongly, but I will read it out. And it says, I think it's item 7, it says the response must in particular set out the Scottish Minister's plans to introduce legislation to criminalise the purchase of sexual services. And I think that's where perhaps the problem lies. Well, it might be an amendment. I do have sympathy, like Margaret Mitchell mentioned and others as well, but it certainly, to me, isn't the proper vehicle when you're talking about trafficked people in that respect. But I think if you actually look at the amendment, you cannot ask a government to introduce a private member's bill which has fallen before. If I get time, Presiding Officer?
Very briefly. Rhoda Grant.
I'll very briefly refer the member to Section 8 of the same amendment, which allows them not to bring forward the legislation.
Sandra White.
I would really question then why put it in if you want them to take it back out again. But I'm just relaying that is what in the amendment, what Rhoda Grant was mentioning is, after introducing legislation, then B says to repeal any enactment which criminalises the selling of sexual services. I find one just puts out the other. So I don't think the amendment, to me, certainly didn't seem competent. But thank you very much, Presiding Officer.
Many thanks. And I now call Malcolm Chisholm.
Presiding Officer, as Jenny Marra said, this is a proud day for the Scottish Parliament that has been 4 years in the making. But as she also reminded us, it's merely the first day in the fight against human trafficking. And it's what happens from now on that will determine how successful this bill has been. There are many people, I think, to thank and congratulate the government, of course, the committee, the cross-party group, many groups, external groups such as TARA, the Traffic Awareness Raising Alliance, the 50,000 people who responded to the consultation, but most of all, Jenny Marra herself, without whom we might not have a bill, and who, I thought a few moments ago, made one of the most eloquent and impassioned speeches that I have ever heard in the Parliament. So I think we're all united today, although of course we had differences at the final amendment stage, but I think we were particularly united round part one of the bill, and we're pleased to see that this grave and brutal offence is now clearly and explicitly laid down in Scots law with very severe sentencing consequences. Obviously, there were some disputes around part one, the statutory defence issue from Margaret Mitchell, Rhoda Grant's amendment, and I repeat what I said then, that there is a strong link between the sex trade and human trafficking, and indeed one of Jenny Marra's many amendments, which wanted to make clear that the criminal offence covered all forms of exploitation. But notwithstanding those differences, there was strong agreement around part one, and the key issue now, of course, is to have a robust strategy to bring the offenders to justice. Now, much of the bill is about the protection of victims and vulnerability as a salient feature in all instances of trafficking, and there were some concerns expressed at stage one about this. I, among many others, made the point that counselling wasn't strong enough, and I'm pleased that an amendment at stage two strengthened that to include psychological assistance and support. I'm not sure if those are the exact words of the amendment, but that's certainly the intention of it. There were also particular concerns at stage one about the vulnerability of children, and I think that's one of those areas where our committee process and amendment process has strengthened the bill considerably. I think it was Christina McKelvey who introduced an amendment about guardians at stage two, and then that was further reinforced by various amendments today, although again I regret that 17 and 18 by Jenny Marra weren't agreed, which I think was clarifying the role and making sure that it was fully comprehensive. Now, protection, the right to support and assistance, it was clearly an important part of the bill, and much of that we heard from the Cabinet Secretary is to be done in regulation. So we'll take a close interest in that. Again, I regret that the Group 6 amendments from Jenny Marra were not agreed in terms of immediate support and the other proposals that she made there. But hopefully all that will be dealt with satisfactorily when it comes to the regulations. Now, as I said at the beginning, quoting Jenny Marra, this is the first day in the fight against trafficking. So the three-year anti-slavery strategy is going to be crucial. Well done, Alison MacInnes, for ensuring that that will come within a year of the bill passing. So clearly, we need to have awareness raising, prevention and detection in that strategy, and also, of course, more about support, which is so crucial. Now, awareness campaign is crucial to ensure that we can help victims escape the clutches of traffickers, and as Jenny Marra said, communities are crucial in this, making communities robust against the cause of trafficking, and also making sure that we have awareness raising training for frontline staff, which Jenny Marra again proposed. I told her I would mention her six times. I think I've exceeded that, but I think that's not inappropriate in the context of this bill, which I warmly welcome.
Many thanks. We now turn to closing speeches and to call on Jamie McGregor. 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. May I start by apologising for not being here for the opening speech of the Minister? My apologies. I'm delighted to have the opportunity to make some closing remarks on today's Stage 3 proceedings on the Human Trafficking and Exploitation Bill. But before turning to the task in hand, I'd like to thank the Justice Committee for the very good scrutiny of the draft legislation, as well as those stakeholders that provided invaluable evidence and contributions throughout its parliamentary passage, including the organisations who provided briefings for today. I particularly welcome the cross-party consensus that legislation is required to combat this insidious practice that is certainly not new, but nevertheless increasingly pervasive. And in May this year, it was reported that 8 people were successfully rescued in human trafficking raids across Scotland in Lanarkshire, Tayside, Fife and Dumfries and Galloway. And it's further emerged that Scots cannabis farms, themselves obviously illegal, are frequently using trafficked children for labour. And women are also trafficked with increasing regularity from West Africa, Europe, Southeast Asia to Scotland, where a life of servitude and inhumane treatment often awaits them. And it's an appalling practice and one that cannot be allowed to continue. But as a largely hidden crime, it is, of course, difficult to quantify the exact extent of human trafficking across the UK. My understanding is that there were 55 such victims in Scotland in 2013, and as many as 4,000 across the UK. No doubt there are very many more than that which go undetected, but action is clearly urgently required, and I'm pleased that the Scottish Government has moved swiftly to legislate on the issue, as have the Westminster and Northern Ireland governments. The Scottish Government has also rightly recognised the cross-border nature of this crime and is coordinating closely with the UK Government to ensure, where practical, a coordinated approach on the issue. Alison McInnes spoke of the evil nature of this crime, and I agree with her. And we all remember the tragedy of the cockle pickers in Morecambe Bay, who were victims of people trafficking. Notwithstanding the comments of the protection of victims, made very well by Margaret Mitchell in her opening remarks, this is a bill of many strengths. Stakeholders seem satisfied that it will have the desired effect of making Scotland a hostile environment for human traffickers and those who exploit the vulnerable for financial gain. However, that legislation is about to be added to the statute book. However, the fact that it's about to be added to the statute book doesn't mean that we should lose sight of the broader issue, which is that traffickers and slave masters will continue to coerce, deceive and force individuals into lives of degradation at source. And the harrowing pictures splashed across the front pages of national newspapers and on our television screens in recent weeks serve as a stark reminder that there are hundreds of thousands of vulnerable people who would stop at nothing in the hope of creating a safer, more secure life for themselves and their families. Human trafficking is a complex, multifaceted and evolving issue, and our response must adapt to keep pace with it. I therefore urge the Scottish Government to carefully and consistently review the legislation, and I similarly encourage the Scottish Parliament to conduct rigorous post-legislative scrutiny of the bill over the coming years to ensure that it remains fit for purpose and future-proof. For there's no doubt that the perpetrators will do everything in their power to exploit and manipulate the vulnerable to their advantage, regardless of any deterrents that are put in place. So we must keep well awake to it.
You must close, please.
Thank you.
Thank you. And I call Elaine Murray. 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And I am delighted to be closing this open debate for Scottish Labour as parliamentary consideration of this very important bill comes to its end. I too would like to pay tribute to Jenny Marrow, whose proposals to legislate prompted 45,000 responses from across the world and were described by Baroness Helena Kennedy, author of the report to which Jenny referred, as being world-leading. I also congratulate CPG for its role in bringing this forward and, of course, the Scottish Government for taking on Jenny Marrow's work in bringing forward this bill, which was based on her bill. Jenny has continued her interest in the bill by proposing amendments to further improvement at stages 2 and 3. And there can be no more appropriate time than this to pass the legislation combating the heinous crime of human trafficking, when every day our television screens and media outlets offer graphic portrayals of refugees fleeing from both persecution in their own lands and the misery of camps in neighbouring lands. The term trafficking for the illegal and often extremely unsafe transportation of these refugees is not always correct, as Rhoda Grant pointed out. Some of these people are being smuggled rather than trafficked when they and if they arrive at their destination, they are dumped there and left to fend for themselves, and this bill will not help them, but those who are being trafficked and being sold on into modern-day slavery in other countries will be helped by this. There have been a number of welcome improvements to the bill since Stage 1, as Alison MacInnes and Malcolm Chisholm referred, in a response to the evidence given to the CUP committee by witnesses. There is an expanded definition of the term trafficking to ensure that people not involved in the actual provision and arranging of travel, but involved in other ways in trafficking, will also be caught by the bill's provisions. References to youth and young have been removed, and the bill makes it clear that a child is defined as a person under 18 years of age. Specific reference has been made to child victims of trafficking, and an aggravation of the offence of human trafficking involving a child has been included. The Lord Advocate will now issue instructions rather than guidance regarding the non-prosecution of the victims of trafficking who have been compelled by their captors to perform illegal activities. Crucially, independent child trafficking guardians have been given a statutory basis. A presumption of age clause was agreed at Stage 2, requiring local authorities and health boards, where there are reasonable grounds to believe that a person is under the age of 18, to consider them to be a child, even if there is no direct proof of age. The amendments at Stage 2 in introducing independent guardians for child victims on a statutory footing were particularly welcome. Child victims of traffickers need someone independent of the statutory agencies, trained to understand the traumatic experience which a child has gone through, and able to help them through the many and very unfamiliar processes which will face them. Relying on a named person who may have little knowledge of the issues faced by trafficked children, as originally proposed, would have been inadequate, and I am pleased that this was recognised. Stage 3 amendments enabling independent child guardians the access to information where they need it as a further improvement. And I am very pleased that Amendment 7 was it, which extended the entitlement of unaccompanied children to independent child guardians. Because these children may be particularly vulnerable to trafficking. In fact, some research drawn to my attention, in fact, by my daughter who's doing work on a mental health nursing qualification, very recent research on the mental health needs of unaccompanied asylum-seeking children really illustrated how particularly vulnerable they are to mental health issues and how difficult it is for those young people to be able to access any assistance or even maybe recognise the problems that they have got. And therefore, an independent guardian will be particularly important for those children who have travelled into this country. They may not have already been trafficked, but they are going to be, because of their situation, they will be particularly vulnerable to be preyed on by traffickers when they get here. Jenny Maher's Amendment 17 recognised that some children are trafficked by their own family members and also have a need for independent statutory legal guardianship. And I hope, since as this amendment wasn't passed, the legislation as it stands will protect these children who are unfortunately being trafficked by their own families and by people close to them. Rhoda Grant had introduced amendments at Stage 2 which would criminalise the purchase of sex and decriminalise its sale. And while some members, myself included, agreed that this would reduce the demand for the trafficking of sex workers, there was some concern in the committee about the introduction of a very significant new policy at Stage 2 of the bill. Rhoda therefore did not press her amendments, and at Stage 3 she introduced a different amendment requiring the government to undertake research on the impacts of criminalisation of the purchases of sex on policy areas such as violence against women and the commercial exploitation of sex, and to report on that to Parliament. But despite the amendment's rejection, we look forward to the publication of the Scottish Government's research and the subsequent discussion of its findings and conclusions, because this issue isn't going to go away. This is still going to continue, and I look forward to hearing that. Finally, in conclusion, this is an extremely important bill. It's a trailblazing bill. But as Jenny Maher, Christina McKelvey, Malcolm Chisholm and others have said, this is only the start of a journey. This is the beginning of, hopefully, the end of human trafficking in Scotland.
Many thanks, and I now call on Michael Matheson to wind up the debate. Cabinet Secretary, you have until 5 p.m.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I say I very much welcome the contribution from across the chamber in the debate this afternoon, and I recognise a very strong sense of cross-party support which exists for this particular piece of legislation, and the need to make sure that we have effective measures and means in place to tackle the abhorrent crime of human trafficking and exploitation. And I recognise that there is a There has been significant work undertaken over a number of years, from Jenny Mara's work through to the cross-party group's work and through a number of other organisations, in highlighting and raising the issue of human trafficking. And I think there's absolutely no doubt that collective effort has led to a greater understanding and determination to address this particular issue as effectively as possible. And clearly from the comments that have been made in the course of this particular debate here this afternoon, there is a considerable level of interest in the development and the shaping of the strategy which this legislation, if passed by Parliament tonight, will place a statutory obligation on ministers to bring forward. What I can assure all members of is that we will have a very thorough and detailed engagement process with interested stakeholders in the development and the taking forward of that particular strategy to ensure that it is as effective and that it hits all of the right points that we need to ensure that the strategy delivers on, to make sure we're doing everything possible to tackle human trafficking and exploitation. And Jenny Mara made a specific reference to the timing of that. Some of the initial work within government has already started in looking at the development of that strategy, but the assurance around that is provided for within the legislation itself, because it must be delivered within 1 year of Section 1 of the bill becoming into force. We have a statutory obligation to make sure that it's delivered within that time frame, and that's why some of that initial work has already started. I'm more than happy to give way to Jenny Mara if that's what she's looking for.
Yes, Jenny Mara. Right. Yes. I thank the Cabinet Secretary for giving way. I was clear on the timing and the obligations that the bill puts on that. I was looking for further clarification on lead accountability and perhaps if there will be a group, perhaps sort of stakeholders that will actually lead this process.
Cabinet Secretary. There's absolutely no doubt that stakeholders will have a key role to play in helping to shape that particular strategy. Not only in shaping the strategy from my perspective, but it's also through looking at the implementation of the strategy over the years once it's been introduced as well. And I want to look at how we can make sure that stakeholders have a meaningful role in helping to make sure that it is effectively being implemented. Whether that's in the form of a reference group or otherwise, I'm very open to that. But I don't want them just to be involved in the shaping of it. I also want them to be involved closely in how it's then taken forward and it's been implemented as well to move towards the 3-year review period that will come up as part of this process. The other issue that Jenny Mara raised, which I thought was an extremely important point, and that is around the provision of training which will be delivered as part of the strategy. And clearly that will be an important part set out within the strategy itself. There's already been some initial discussions with the NHS in this area and also with Police Scotland, and I think there are other sectors that can play their part in this as well. One of the things I think we have to give some consideration to, careful consideration to, is the issue of quality and quantity of that training. And what I want to do is to make sure that as we take forward any measures around the training provisions which are developed and implemented, is that we don't lose sight of the quality aspect in trying to reach a greater number. So we need to make sure that we get that balance right, and we have to give some careful consideration to that matter, and that will certainly be a key part of the work that we look at taking forward as part of the strategy. I want to turn, though, to... I'll give way to the member, of course. Jenny Mara.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for giving way again. I wonder if he noted my suggestions about training for our lawyers. The Faculty of Advocates is holding an event on the 10th of October this year, but I think it might also be an idea to speak to the universities and their legal schools about training on statutory criminal law as well as common law.
In some ways, actually, the legislation actually, I think, will help to ensure, it gives us a greater opportunity to ensure that there's an awareness raised amongst those who are undertaking law degrees. But I'm more than open to looking at what different groups that we should be targeting as part of any training regime that's necessary in this area. Kit, I want to turn to an issue that Margaret Mitchell raised, and that was the issue around the statutory defence issue. And of course, the difference that we have from the government's approach in this matter from the approach that Margaret Mitchell would wish us to take. Can I say in the strongest possible terms, it is simply wrong to suggest that this bill as it stands provides less protection than the Modern Slavery Act does. We have taken a different approach around this matter. We don't believe that a statute of defence is the appropriate approach here in Scotland, that the Lord Advocate's instructions is a better and much more effective way in which to do that. As the Lord Advocate said himself, is that by taking the approach through Lord Advocate's instructions, it is less likely that we will see injustices being served here in Scotland as a result. But I think it is fundamentally wrong to suggest that this bill provides less protection. That's certainly not the case. And in fact, if the member let me finish this point, in fact, there are those who are actually raising significant questions about the workability of the statute of defence provision that's in the Modern Slavery Act because of the 130 exceptions and carve-outs that are being created within it. We don't have that complexity in what we are providing within our legislation, which is why the Lord Advocate is of the view that it will reduce the risk of injustices being served here in Scotland because of the pragmatic and victim-centred approach we're taking here. I'll give way to the member.
Margaret Mitchell.
The point is, Cabinet Secretary, you could have had both, and it would have probably made even better legislation than there is elsewhere in the UK. But isn't it true? The bottom line was it would have cost more to provide a statute of defence, and that was the real reason that it wasn't included, along with the Lord Advocate's guidance and instructions.
Well, I must confess that is one of the most bizarre arguments I have ever heard around the issue of a statute of defence. It was nothing to do with costs. What it was about was taking the right approach and getting the right balance, and that's exactly what we've achieved. And I do regret the tone that the member has set around this idea that this bill does not set the right level of protections. It does quite the opposite, and we as a parliament should be very proud of achieving that in the way in which we have done as well. Can I also turn briefly to the issue around NRMs as well, which Margaret Mitchell raised? That's a matter which we are continuing to have discussions with the Home Office on. There are two pilots, North West Yorkshire and in Cornwall, and we'll continue to engage with them as that issue moves forward. Just in drawing my remarks to a close, Presiding Officer, a number of members have said that this is the first day, the start of the process of tackling human trafficking. I don't entirely agree with that, because there's already been a significant amount of work already undertaken in tackling human trafficking through our law enforcement agencies and through our prosecution services, some of which were referred to by Jamie McGregor, and also through third sector organisations. What this bill is that this is the first day where we have upped the stakes in terms of making sure that Scotland is a hostile environment for those that want to peddle in the misery that's associated with human trafficking and exploitation. The message is very clear. In supporting this bill tonight, you're not welcome here. And for those who are victims of this appalling crime, this is a haven and a sanctuary that will support them to overcome the abuse that they've experienced.
That concludes the debate on the Human Trafficking and Exploitation Scotland Bill. We now move to the next item of business, which is decision time. There is one question to be put as a result of today's business. The question is that motion number 14421, in the name of Michael Matheson, on the Human Trafficking and Exploitation Scotland Bill be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed to, and the Human Trafficking and Exploitation Scotland Bill is passed. That concludes decision time, and I now close this meeting.